Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our service here in Minto Church. I have two announcements to make today. The newsletter deadline is tomorrow, so if you have any items for the newsletter, could you please let Nancy Smith know today or tomorrow at the very latest what you would like to include. And there are some of these books. These books have been written by Michael Braithwaite, previously our treasurer. Michael's now confined to the house, but he's discovered a new career late in life as a writer and a poet, and his writings are inspirational and very interesting, so I recommend this to you. I've stole your money for this, Alice. Thank you. Our call to worship this morning comes from Galatians. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. We'll begin by singing, "Let us build a house where love can dwell," which is 198 in our hymn books. Let us build a house where love can dwell.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, creator of the universe and all that lies within it, we give you thanks for the breadth of your imagination, for the depth of your creativity, and for the seed of your very self planted deep within everything. We rejoice that there is nothing that your hands have not touched, from the tiniest bud to the most majestic mountain, from the simplest life form to the most complicated of beings. Everything carries your signature. In the light of all that is, we are humbled to think of the care and love that you show to each human being, male and female, old and young, those with every opportunity and those with none. Help us to know your closeness, as here in your presence we open ourselves to your healing, forgiving, encouraging and challenging touch. And hear us, we pray, as we add our voices to those of all your people, of all sorts, everywhere, as we say together the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our first reading this morning is Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, your greatness is seen in all the world. Your praise reaches up to the heavens. It is sung by children and babes. You are safe and secure from all your enemies. You stop anyone who opposes you. When I look at the sky which you have made, at the moon and the stars which you set in their places, what is man that you think of him? Mere man, that you care for him. Yet you made him inferior only to yourself. You crowned him with glory and honour. You appointed him ruler over everything you made. You placed him over all creation, sheep and cattle and the wild animals too, the birds and the fish and the creatures in the seas. O Lord, our Lord, your greatness is seen in all the world. Amen. And our second reading comes from the second letter to Timothy, chapter 2, and just a few verses, 15 and 19 to 21. Do your best to win full approval in God's sight, as a worker who's not ashamed of his work, one who correctly teaches the message of God's truth. The solid foundation that God has laid cannot be shaken, and on it are written these words, "The Lord knows those who are his," and "Whoever says that he belongs to the Lord must turn away from wrongdoing." In a large house, there are dishes and bowls of all kinds. Some are made of silver and gold, others of wood and clay. Some are for special occasions, others for ordinary use. If anyone makes himself clean from all these evil things, he will be used for special purposes, because he is dedicated and useful to his master, ready to be used for every good deed. Amen. Thanks be to God for his word. And we're now going to sing again. This is "Lord, for the years your love has kept and guided," number 159 in the hymnbook. Lord, for the years. She was playing before Mhairi's, the Scottish song, which kind of gives you a clue to the service theme today. It is the seven Mhairi's today, not the three Mhairi's, the four Mhairi's. Mhairi's not such a fashionable Mhairi anymore. There's only one Mhairi in the whole Celtic high school. My grandma was called Mhairi, so it was quite a fashionable name, and my own name is a variation, a Gaelic variation of Mhairi. It's a very ancient name. And was not so new when Mhairi became the mother of Christ. So it's hardly surprising that there are so many of the women mentioned in the Bible that are called Mhairi. Perhaps it's maybe surprising there's not more of them. But as I said, in total, seven different Mhairis are mentioned in the New Testament. Five of them appear in the Gospels, one appears in Acts, and the seventh is mentioned in Paul's letter, second letter to the Romans. A couple of the Mhairis are well known, but the tantalising, frustrating thing is that sometimes these men, women are only mentioned in passing. So it can be very easy indeed to mix them up or even create a composite picture of them and they all can emerge into one.
And given the lack of details about them, theologians and historians can only conjecture as to the role in the early church. The gospel description of Jesus' death on the cross provides an example of this confusion. In all, four Marys are stated as standing at the base of the cross, depending on which version you read, but not all the descriptions are the same. In John 19, verse 25, we learn of three Marys present at Jesus' crucifixion. Standing near his cross were Jesus' mother, his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. So what do we know about these women? Well, firstly, Mary, the mother of Jesus, who appears seven times in the Gospels, both before and after becoming Christ's mother, faithfully accepting God's plan and obeying his work, from Jesus' conception to his death on the cross. Secondly, Mary, the wife of Clopas, who stood with Jesus' mother at the foot of the cross. This is her only mention in the Bible, although she may be the unnamed disciple who accompanied Cleophas on the road to Emmaus and had that memorable meeting with our Lord as described in Luke 24, verse 13-15. And thirdly, Mary Magdalene, who has been a contentious figure in the church's history, and many myths and legends have grown up around her. But this is not what is said in the Bible. Mark 16 and Luke 8 mention that seven demons had been driven out of her. As a result, she recognised and followed Jesus as her Lord and Saviour. And she was also one of the first to see Jesus once he rose from the dead. This cannot have been just a happy chance, but part of God's plan for her. However, in Matthew's description of the women of the crucifixion, verses 55 and 56, we read, there were many women there, looking on from a distance, who had followed Jesus from Galilee and helped him. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the wife of Zebedee. So Mary, the mother of James and Joseph and wife of Zebedee, watched as Jesus' body was laid in the tomb, and she also came after the Sabbath with the other woman to prepare our Lord's body with spices. But this is all we are told of her life. And the others? Well, apart from the other four mentioned before, the only other one mentioned in the Gospel is Mary, the sister of busy Martha, who sat at our Lord's feet to hear him speak. He was also the sister of Lazarus, who was raised from the dead. We will learn a little more about our other Marys after our next hymn, which is There's a Whiteness in God's Mercy, which is hymn 187. A Whiteness in God's Mercy, 187.
Said before,
We know so little about the life of Mary, wife of Clopas, or Mary, wife of Zebedee, but we can work something out about their lives from our knowledge of what life was like for ordinary women in biblical times. So we have a little imagine. Life has taken a strange turn recently. In just a few months, I've gone from being a wife and mother, looking for my sons to marry, waiting for grandchildren, looking forward with apprehension to my old age. In short, I was a homebody, never setting my perspectives further than my own little area. Now I've become almost a nomad, tramping around from village to village, following the teacher. My entire life up until now has been spent in a tiny village by the lake, a collection of scattered mud brick houses, surrounded by the same neighbours for generations, with only rare visits to Jerusalem. I really thought I was so lucky to marry into Zebedee's family, four entire rooms and a roof area for ourselves. And we had more space than some. As fishermen, we didn't keep as many animals, but we still had gardens and fields to tend, as well as housework, bedding to be lifted and aired, water to be fetched, grain to be milled, fires to be lit and tended, and meals to be cooked. And not small ones either. Fishermen take a bit of feeding. Every day a repetition of the last, or very nearly so. The start of our life together wasn't easy. Fitting in with Zebedee's mother and her way of doing things was a struggle. She was a very particular, efficient woman, and there was merely a moment of leisure for Zebedee and me to spend together. That's what's been so different about following Jesus with my sons. Yes, there are busy times too when we're trying to feed groups of followers, but the most important thing here and now is to listen, to sit down and learn from him. Some of the references in the stories I don't always follow, but then again, I'm not as educated as the boys. No woman here has had the benefit of a synagogue education. Zebedee's mother would be horrified about what we're doing now. She was such a traditionalist. Women getting involved in religious matters, women learning, she would be throwing her hands up in horror. But this is more, ever so much more. I wish she'd had a chance to hear the teacher. He made so much more sense than all the rules I learned as a child. We'll sing again, and this time we're singing from Songs of God's People. It's hymn 72. Lord Jesus Christ, you have come to us, also known as Living Lord. That's hymn 72. Lord Jesus Christ.
You are
taken from Luke chapter 8, verses 1 to 3. This is from the New Century Version, also known as the Youth Bible. The group with Jesus. After this, while Jesus was travelling through some cities and small towns, he preached and told the good news about God's kingdom. The 12 apostles were with him, and also some women who had been healed of sickness and evil spirits. Mary called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out, Joanna, the wife of Tuva, the manager of Herod's house, Susanna, and many others. These women used their own money to help Jesus and his apostles. One of the revolutionary elements of Jesus' ministry was that he opened up his teaching to all, including women who were very much second-class citizens at the time. In the patriarchal Jewish society of the period, the norm was for women to fulfill traditional household roles. As Jesus' apostles, however, they were permitted to play a much fuller part, allowed to help, we assume, in the mission and evangelism, not just in the cooking and cleaning. The gospel reading we have just heard informs us that the women, among them Mary Magdalene, were supporting Jesus' ministry financially. So we can also assume that these women were relatively well off in their own right. This precedent is carried on in the early church, as we can tell from fleeting mentions of our final two Marys. Firstly, Mary, mother of John Mark, and it was to her home that Peter went after his release from prison, as it states in Acts chapter 12, verse 12. Aware of his situation, he went to the home of Mary, the mother of John Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. And the second Mary, a follower of Jesus in Rome, who is greeted by name in Paul's letter to the Romans, where he states, "She has worked so hard for you." By opening their homes for the first Christians to meet, they were carrying on the precedent set by Mary Magdalene and others. But overall, what can we learn from these, our 7 Marys? We are also called to give our time, talents, and money in this day and age to help with the work of the church and the various organisations that are related to it. This might be through one of the Christian charities, such as Christian Aid or Mary's Meals, or it might be with helping with a club of young people, such as Boys Brigade, Girls Brigade, or even joining the Guild in our own church here. We may choose to donate or volunteer with other Christian causes, either locally, nationally, or internationally. Whatever we do, our service and giving is recognised by God as being done in His name and to His glory. Secondly, by following Jesus and carrying out His commands, these women went out of their comfort zones. They did things that were not normally allowed in their society. No doubt the women welcomed this chance to be accepted, not to be divided away from the men. The Church of Scotland was one of the earliest churches to recognise the potential of women in ministry. The Guild was established in 1887. The first deaconess, Lady Grizzle Bailey, was set apart in 1888 in Bowden Kirk. In 1966, the General Assembly recognised the eligibility of women for eldership, and 3 years later, in 1969, the first female minister was ordained. And just 5 years ago, women represented a little over half of the eldership and approximately one-third of ministers. With the changes coming in presbytery structure and in the deployment of ministers, we are also going to be called to step out of our comfort zones. For us, these women hold out a message of hope. We can follow their example. We can challenge the norm. The things that have I been in our own small part of the church. We can act as facilitators. That might mean working to improve the experience of worship, playing a part in getting others to recognise the wonder of God's forgiveness, planning for the future, or simply providing unobtrusive assistance through prayer. Finally, above all, these women knew that God loved them. They didn't appear to be anything special, but they were so special that their names were recorded in his book. And so are we known to God. We are special to him. Amen. And may God add his blessing to this, his reflection and his word.
Let us pray. These prayers are for our offerings, the prayers of thanksgiving and intercession for others and ourselves. Our gracious God and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that we matter to you and that everyone matters to you so much that you even gave your Son to become one of us and die for us. We thank you that in Jesus we see how much we matter to you. When we think of these things, what can we do but be amazed and gladly give you offerings of our money and of ourselves, asking that you use them to help others to know how much they matter to you. Loving Father, we ask that you guide our feet so that we may walk in the footsteps of your Son, Jesus. We ask that you guide and counsel those going through hard times and struggling to find solutions. We ask that you send them a comforter. Where people are suffering injustice, we cry out for wrongs to be righted and for there to be justice for all. Bless all children and those who care for them. For those suffering abuse, we pray for a place of safety that they may know love. For people in war zones, especially the people in Ukraine, we pray for peace. For those suffering hunger, we pray for food from your world's great bounty. Give us understanding of those who struggle for whatever reason. Help us to recognise their plight. We thank you for all the Mhairis we've heard about today, and we thank you for all who have carried the torch of faith throughout the ages. We think of the people we have known who are no longer with us and who have helped us on our own journey of faith. We make our prayers in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. Our final hymn is For All the Saints, which is number 740, For All the Saints.
Thank you.
beside us. Christ be before us. Christ be above us, King of our hearts. Christ be within us. Christ be below us. Christ be below above us, never to part. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among us today and remain with us evermore.